Okay, so you remember what we did last time?
Yes, we did path of a thrown object.
And what was the angle that we found out?
We found out some thing.
At what angle it has to be thrown so that
it can go the farthest?
So that it can go the farthest.
45 degrees.
45 degrees. And why was 45 degrees?
Because that is the angle that will create the dimensions of a square. Or that will create the dimensions when decomposed.
Uh-huh.
It will make the dimensions of a square.
Dimensions of a square, basically.
Through x and
the
y.
The horizontal velocity and vertical velocity will be
same.
Equally divided. Correct?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So, I did not know I can explain that.
You did. So today we are doing something new.
What?
Circular motion.
Why?
Because motion is circular.
Why? Why is it circular?
So,
because of the equation which we did yesterday.
No, how will circular motion be different? What we did, the path of bullet, is it straight motion? It is not, yes?
It's a curved motion. It's a circular motion.
It is not a circular motion,
it's
but it
curve.
Is motion along a curve.
Hmm.
Motion along a curve can always be divided into, usually has to be divided into, two decomposed into two vectors to get, make some sense out of it.
Two vectors?
Vertical, V horizontal and V vertical. Remember?
Hmm? Not valves. I hate valves.
Valves. Okay. So, what he says is that if a point moves around a circle, the motion is accelerated. If
true.
Only because of the velocity, because the velocity is changing its direction all the time.
Give me the remote. Okay, for 22, I turn 23. Now I turn 21. Keep it on 21.
So, if a point moves around a circle, the motion is accelerated. If only because the velocity is changing its direction all the time. The speed may remain constant. It may be moving at a
but
a
speed
same.
Is not a vector.
Speed is not a vector, but
that's why it will stay constant. But velocity is a vector, that's why.
It will not stay constant. Even if it stays constant, the velocity will still be accelerated because of changing direction.
Yeah, I don't know why it's called accelerated, but okay.
What is acceleration?
Constant increase of speed at a particular time.
Not increase of speed. It is change in velocity
oh,
over time.
Oh, acha, correct.
It is not speed.
Acha, I forgot. Change in velocity over time.
Change in velocity over time. So, velocity is changing even if only the direction is changing.
Yeah, because it's a vector, so it doesn't matter.
So, it doesn't matter if the speed is same, if the direction is changing, it is acceleration.
Acceleration.
And you will be surprised. You remember we also read that acceleration is caused by a force.
Yes.
Correct? That means for something to move in a circle or
yeah, I remember motion. You told me this.
A circular motion requires a force.
Yeah.
Because it is continuously changing the direction, that means continuously the force has to be applied. The moment you stop applying the force, immediately the thing will go into its
original state.
What is original state? Uniform rectilinear motion.
I did not remember that wording, but okay.
Correct?
Yes.
So, uniform rectilinear motion
means? If you said it, it is correct.
So, uniform rectilinear motion means it will go into a straight line.
Yeah.
without changing direction at a constant speed the moment you stop applying the force. Okay, so that much we have understood. Okay, he says that we shall draw the velocity vectors at successive time intervals and transfer their initial points to a single point. We have the right to do this. If a velocity vector is rotated through a small angle, the change in velocity, as we know, will be represented by the base of an isosceles triangle. Okay, I'll tell you this.
I know. I can see the picture, you know.
Yeah, you can see the picture, correct. Base of an isosceles triangle.
This. What is the drawing?
This.
Yeah.
Okay. This is the base of the isosceles triangle. Okay.
What nonsense is this?
Let us construct the change in velocity during the course of a complete revolution of a body. The sum of the magnitudes of the changes in velocity during the complete revolution will be equal to the sum of the sides of the depicted polygon. In constructing such a small triangle, we have implicitly assumed that the velocity vector changes by jumps.
Huh?
But its direction is actually changing continuously. It is perfectly clear that the smaller we make this vertex angle of this small triangle, less will be our error. The smaller the side of angle, the less, okay. The smaller the sides of polygon, closer we will they cling to the circle of radius V. Okay.
I'm telling the camera in your voice. I'm like, look, I'm like, okay, is this a man hanging to that giant box thing? This is a finger.
Okay, continuously, okay, wait. Continuously, the exact value, consequently, the exact value of the sum of the magnitudes of the changes in velocity during the course of a revolution to a, of a point will be the circumference of 2 pi v of the circle. Magnitude of acceleration is found by dividing this by time to a complete revolution.
Found by dividing what of time? This what by time?
The...
We have the right of drawing what picture? I didn't understand the picture. Except for the triangle part. Everything I understood that. I didn't understand what's going on over here. Why is there a man just hanging from a giant box of giantness? Is this a man's head? What is this? Okay, I understood everything in this drawing now. Okay. Isosceles 1, V1, isosceles V2, Santhangotati, Potatapotati.
Okay, let's try to draw this.
Tatsan. Record started. Wait, let me face recognize. Come on.
Okay, so let us say something is moving in a circle. So,
please press this button to erase.
What this guy does is, there is something hanging on a or somebody hanging on a rope, something hanging on a rope, okay, and it is,
what is this motion called? I remember you told me what this force is called.
The
centrifugal force.
That force will come later.
Centrifugal force.
Yeah, it is called centrifugal force, but it will come later.
That's okay. A very bad circle.
So let's say this is how this chap is moving, or okay, this thing is moving as along with time. So okay, so what he has done is, let's say this is at point 1, point 2, point 3,
why don't you just write
4,
right?
Okay,
triangle V1. Okay, continue.
Okay, let's say at this time he has got a velocity in this direction. This is V1. Mm-hmm. Okay. Here he's got a velocity like this. This is V2. Okay. Here he has got a velocity like this.
Wouldn't it be like this?
Huh?
Matlab? Like, wouldn't it go along the circle like this?
No, sir. We are at this instant, at this point, at this time, he has got a velocity this. Next instant the velocity changes direction.
Okay.
But at this instant, remember I had told you something about a tangent?
Yes, I do.
Yeah. So this is the tangent at this point. That will be the direction.
Isn't tangent that point of the circle?
No.
Circle
tangent, no. Tangent is when you draw a line on a circle or on a curve. If this is the center, correct?
Hmm.
And you draw a perpendicular to that circle at that point. Correct? Tangent is something like if something is attached to a rope, okay, and is being rotated with that rope, and suddenly the rope breaks.
Okay, understood why you did like this now.
So suddenly,
because you said it's 90 degrees to this now, so it has to be 90.
Yeah, it has to be 90 degrees. Suddenly the rope breaks. What will be the direction in which that thing will throw?
The tangent.
That will be the tangent, correct. So this direction at this every point is given by the tangent, and again same way you will have V4 like this, or V4 something like that. Okay, so V1, V2, V3. Now you remember how we used to do vector addition and vector differentiation? To find the acceleration we have to do vector difference of these two things.
I forgot how to do addition.
So
and
if you wanted to add two vectors, you took vector 1 like this.
Oh right, we did the rhombus.
Yeah, you either use a rhombus rule or you use a, so in case let's say there's V1 and V2 will go something like this, correct?
So we do this.
But this will give us the sum.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
What we want is difference. So for difference what we used to do was join or take the, you made a rhombus, remember? Like this. And this was the difference, correct?
Yes.
Yes.
I forgot about the difference.
So you can basically what you have to do is get both the vectors to same point, origin point, correct? Like this, V1 and V2, and this will be now the difference, correct? Okay. So because we are looking at lot of points, lot of circles, in a circular motion, so what we are doing now is that in order to get all of them and find out the difference, we start drawing them in a from a same common point so that we can find out the difference between each. So you get V1 like this, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Now since we are assuming that the speed is not changing, it is only the direction which is changing, that means the value or the speed value of V1, V2, V3 will all be same, correct? So V1, okay, so you get this V1, then you get this V2.
What is
accurately
doing it?
Because ultimately we'll have to get to a circle now. Let's see how good a circle I can draw.
That's an amazing circle.
Not a good circle.
It's amazing. What do you mean?
Okay,
that's so not that one.
These are not the one we chose then.
We are changing it.
Okay. So we take the center point. This becomes V1.
Why?
Then you have
V1. Why do you have to do so much? You know how much is the difference?
No, but this is just representative. Now we have got a circle. Let's say it is this much now. Let's say we have scaled it, whatever. V3. Okay, same way. As the circle keeps going, we will have V4.
Wow, that's a big line.
Yeah.
I'm requesting if you want to erase something, please press the button while writing so that it will erase. If you want to erase something.
V6.
V7. V8. V nonsense. V8 ke baad V nonsense hota hai. No, that's V nonsense. Okay, V9.
Okay, V9. Okay. So, what we are trying to find out is acceleration, and what is it going to be? Change in direction or yeah, change in velocity. So, difference between V1 and V2 is?
Magnitude was direction, right?
Hmm?
Magnitude is direction, no?
Magnitude is value, direction is direction.
Alright, okay.
So, the direction is going to be, the difference is going to be this. Let me do this with a different color.
Green.
Try this. Okay, green. If you see green.
Please, I love green.
Okay.
It's also your favorite color.
So, V1 to V2, this is going to be the difference. V2 to V3, this is going to be the difference. So, difference is also indicated in mathematics by delta, or small differences are indicated by delta.
What's delta?
Delta is represented by this triangle. Okay.
Hmm.
It's again that Greek letter delta. Okay, there are
okay.
two. One is delta like this, and one is delta represented like this. I think this is capital delta, if I'm not wrong.
What is theta?
So we call it.
It was alpha, beta, theta, delta. Then it was.
Okay.
Eta.
Okay. Now this is delta V 1. Now this is.
Okay, that's what the triangle was.
Two.
I thought that was.
Delta. Yeah. Now you understood the triangle why how it is.
Yeah. Now I understand why it was triangle. I thought that is just to show that it's isosceles triangle one. Isosceles triangle base V1, oh my god.
Delta V5, okay, and so on and so forth. Okay, now what he's trying to say is that.
Draw the full now.
Okay, enough. What he's trying to say is that, of course, the actual object is moving in a circle. Yes? What we are doing is that we are taking velocities at different points. Yeah? And calculating the difference between V1 and V2. Of course, there is a lot of time difference between V1 and V2, between this point and this point. Correct?
Mm.
So, more accurate we want to calculate, you have to take it at different point. Correct? Closer point. Yahan pe. Hai na? You should take just after this point. If you take just after this point, the angle difference between V1 and V2 is quite a lot here. But if you just take next point, the angle difference is going to be very less. Means you might end up with something which is like just here, correct?
Mm.
At the edge of the circle.
Mm.
And then this delta V will only be this much. Correct? Okay?
Mm.
Understood?
Mm.
And what is delta V?
Delta V is the addition.
The difference between V1 and V2. Difference, not addition. Difference.
How is that difference?
In vectors, this is the difference, no? And okay. This is the sum. Correct?
Yeah, this is the sum.
This is the sum and this is the difference.
Oh, achha, okay.
Correct?
Yeah.
So we are taking this is this one, no?
Hmm.
So obviously. So that is the thing. So this is the difference.
Hmm.
And as we try to get more and more accurate, ultimately this delta will just become a point on this circumference.
True.
Okay. If you agree.
That's how we actually don't feel the straight.
Yeah. So
straight because the difference is so less.
Difference is so less. Correct. So basically, this is just an assumption that the velocity is changing in jumps, but it is changing continuously. So delta v at each time is only point. Correct. So if you add all these points, now what is delta v? Delta v is change in velocity. If you add all these points, what will you get?
What is delta representing again?
Difference.
Okay.
Small difference. So if you add all these points, what will you get?
360.
Circumference of the circle.
Okay. Yeah.
Correct? Yes.
Something is wrong with me.
Circumference of the circle?
Yes.
Circumference of a circle whose radius is how much?
V1,
V2, V3, V4 all are same, no? The magnitude of all of them is same.
Hmm.
Only the direction is different.
So it's...
Let's say this...
It's magnitude.
Let's say this magnitude is now...
It's M.
Is V. Let's call it V.
Vm.
Okay?
Vm.
So V is equal to the radius and the circumference is going to be 2 pi r. That means...
2 pi r.
2 pi V, or we call it small v, I think it's called it small v. So let's not confuse them. Small v. Okay. So this is going to be small v. I'm used to using that thing. Not
I know.
Used to pressing that term. So it's going to be 2 pi V. And what is this 2 pi V? Sum of all changes in velocity. Passion.
Correct.
Sum of all changes in velocity. So, and what is acceleration? Change in velocity over?
Time.
Over time. Let's say this thing which is rotating took t seconds.
Time seconds.
To complete the full circle.
Time seconds,
yeah. T seconds to complete the full circle.
Hmm.
So, what will be the acceleration? Total change in velocity divided by total time. So acceleration over entire 360 degrees will be total change in velocity, which is 2 pi V. Hana? 2 pi V is the circumference, which is the addition of all delta V's. Correct? So 2 pi V upon T becomes the acceleration of something which is rotating at a constant speed of V along a circular path, not a curved path, but a circular path.
That's why it just go like blue. How did you understand why blue? I said blue and you're like
The time of complete revolution in motion around a circle of radius r can be expressed in the form t is equal to 2 pi r upon v. Substituting the expression to this thing. Now what is this?
Okay. I didn't understand a single thing it just said. Because it's extremely confusing. Because I also didn't hear anything you just said. You did some. You said t is equal to 2 pi r by v.
Okay, this is as per the change in directions. Okay?
Why?
Okay?
Why?
This is where we have found out acceleration in terms of velocity and time t.
Why?
Okay? Now, let's take something completely different. This is fine. Mm-hmm. Okay. What is the speed of this thing? Not velocity, speed.
Mm-hmm. V.
Correct? Same speed, only direction changing.
Mm-hmm. how is speed v?
The value of speed, so the magnitude of speed is going to be v, no?
Okay.
Correct?
Yeah, okay.
It is traveling at v meters per second, only changing its direction continuously. Correct? So if it's traveling at same speed along the circumference, and let's say the it's not traveling along this circumference actually, no, that is wrong. This is only the velocity vector ka circle. The actual thing is moving on a rope, hai na? Jiska ki length is R, let's say. Hai na?
Uska length is V.
This length is V. We have taken out all this and joined them all together because we wanted to do vector differentiation. This length is still R. Correct? So this is not the circle of the item which is moving. The circle of the item is completely different. This.
Now I remember because you wanted to put it all in one point.
Correct. Yeah, remember? For vector differentiation.
To make more sense.
But the actual thing is moving along a.
Route.
Along a circle
which looks horrible.
Okay. Which is an object tied on a rope which is length R. Okay. And this is moving at a speed or as a velocity which has got a value of V. Correct? So what is the path it travels in this much time? The circumference of this circle, not this circle, this circle. Correct?
Mm.
So the total distance that it travels is how much? 2 pi r. Correct? What is the speed it is traveling at?
V.
At V. Correct?
Mm.
So how much time will it take? The distance it goes is 2 pi r. The speed it traveling at is V. How much time will it take to do this complete circle? Speed divided by velocity, or speed divided by distance divided by speed. The total distance it has traveled is 2 pi r, and the speed is v. So the time will be 2 pi r upon v. Now can you see that there is one t here? That means instead of this t we can put this whole thing.
Why do we like doing that so much?
That is how we get the relations in the terms which we want actually. Okay? So let's do that now.
Please put this in yellow.
This part in yellow you want?
You're referring to that only, na?
Okay, let's see. Okay, let's
just
do that.
Because you're referring to that.
Which means
that A is equal to 2 pi v by 2 pi r by v. What is this?
2 pi r by v.
Why are there so many bys?
So this v can go up now basically.
Okay. Now it makes more sense.
2 pi v. I'll just show you.
2 pi v
upon 1. Okay. Divided by 2 pi r upon v. This is what this means. This one. Correct? If you want to divide something, you can multiply it by the reverse fraction, remember? Correct? Hai na? So that means this becomes 2 pi v upon 1 into v upon 2 pi r. Correct?
Which is
basically just taking this V up. Yes?
So it's making it 2 pi.
So 2 pi and 2 pi can get cancelled. There's 2 pi here, there's 2 pi here. They get cancelled. So what remains is?
VV.
Which is?
Vivek.
V square.
I said Vivek.
Which is?
Vivek
V square upon R.
What?
Hai na?
Yeah, I knew that v square of 2v will come.
So, now what we have got? What is all this? Acceleration. Acceleration is equal to
this
v square
stuff.
Upon r.
This stuff. See, this stuff. Wait, don't do the pen. This stuff. That's a very bad arrow.
This is an arrow, okay.
No, wrong. It goes to there. It's supposed to go there.
Not going there.
Okay. Because it's gone. It's no longer alive.
So what is this now? Acceleration is equal to v square upon r.
We so did such a big thing to get that.
What is the advantage now? We don't need time.
We don't need anything else. We don't need time.
Basically, what it shows is that
we don't need 2 pi.
So let's, what is it saying? It's saying that if something is being rotated in a circle or something is moving in a circle at a constant speed, not constant velocity, at a constant speed of v, okay? And the radius of the circle on which it is moving is r, then its acceleration is going to be v square divided by r. This is true for anything which is moving at a constant speed on a circle.
Can we do one?
This is the thing.
No, I'm saying set a value.
Anyway, yeah, you can set a value, but
once I want to say.
It will not matter.
Anyways. I just want to say this.
Okay, let's say v want, what you want to say, v is equal to 10 meters per second.
Okay.
Yeah,
v is what?
Speed,
correct.
Speed. The radius of the circle on which it is moving?
5 meters.
5 meters.
Okay. If everything on the same,
okay.
Same unit.
Yeah, everything on the same. So now the acceleration is going to be 10 into 10 upon 5.
Which is equal to 100 upon 5
I still remember that. So that means that something moving at 10 meters per second along a radius of 5 meters with, even though traveling at constant speed, will be continuously accelerating at 20 meters per second square.
Acceleration is a vector, right?
Acceleration is a vector.
Yes, that's right. So mean the velocity also has this same type of units. Velocity, what are the units of velocity?
Meters per second.
Isn't that the unit of speed?
Isn't the speed and unit of velocity same, sir?
Oh, it's
only thing is the velocity also has a direction on it.
So that's the unit of time.
No, but the unit remains same.
Unit remains same, but there's a...
There's a direction.
This equal to sign with the direction of
not
it.
Equal to sign, an arrow sign. It is just to show that there is a direction. It is a velocity. The direction is actually
that
given.
That actually shows a ray.
No, the direction is actually given in a different manner. You either have a.
Is a ray just a vector?
Ray is a ray. Sir. Vector is. Vector, ray is just a line drawn with an arrow. Or line drawn and extending to infinity in one direction. That has got nothing to do with vectors. Vectors are physical quantities like speed. Yeah.
Okay.
You get acceleration by dividing velocity and time. Velocity is a vector. Yes. And time is not a vector. Scalar.
What is scalar?
Scalar are quantities which don't have a direction. So time is actually time difference. Okay.
So that means
a vector divided by a scalar will give you a vector quantity.
Can I say something?
Okay.
Yes. Vector.
So that is
vector divided by a scalar is equal to a vector.
Will give you a vector quantity, correct?
Is it vector?
Vector divided by vector might give you a scalar quantity.
Scalar divided by that makes no sense.
Yeah, that you will learn later on.
Baba, listen.
Okay, no.
That means speed is a scalar.
Sorry?
Speed is a scalar,
yes.
Okay. Now everything makes sense.
Good.
It just gave a name to everything.
Good.
Stop recording. Don't close this. This is a thing. For a what?
Okay. So that means that for a constant radius of rotation, that is R, if the radius is of the circle remains same or it is moving in exact circle, the acceleration is proportional to the square of speed. Okay. For a given speed, the acceleration is inversely proportional to radius. Okay. This same reasoning shows us how the acceleration of circular motion is directed at each given instant. Okay.
What?
Acceleration is a vector. That means that also has to have a direction.
Mm.
Hmm? No.
Why is everything so confusing?
So we.
Why does everything not end? Why does it have to go to some place? Continue, please.
So, how do you know ki what is going to be the direction of the
acceleration
at each of these instances?
Kuch nahi hua, papa.
So, when this change is happening, what is the direction of the instance? I think what we need to do is pen only. Where is this thing? There is a button here which makes it only pen. Forget it.
This?
Okay. The reasoning shows us. Okay. So, what he says is that because acceleration changes along with square of velocity and it changes inversely or opposite to the radius. Lesser the radius, more will be the acceleration.
Wow. Okay.
Instead of 5 meters, if you had 2 meters here, then it would have been 50 meters per second square. Velocity remains same, but the acceleration would have increased.
Oh, makes sense.
Okay, so that is what he said.
And okay. It also makes sense mathematically.
Yes, of course.
this reasoning of this proportionality
also gives us some idea as to what will be the direction of the acceleration at each time. Okay. The smaller the vertex angle of the isosceles triangle which we used in our proof,
isosceles triangle,
the nearer the angle between the increment in velocity and the velocity will be 90 degree. Therefore, the acceleration of the uniform circular motion is directed perpendicular to velocity.
What is there was a word which you said which I didn't know about. I didn't understand anything you just said.
Okay, what he says is if this was not a circular motion, if it's a normal straight motion, let's say, so if the velocity reduces, acceleration is negative, correct?
Mm.
If the velocity increases, the acceleration is
positive,
okay?
Mm.
Which means that the direction of acceleration is towards the change in velocity. If the change of velocity is positive, the acceleration is also positive,
mm.
has a positive direction. If the velocity is reducing and the change of velocity is negative, then
acceleration is opposite.
It also has the negative direction. Correct?
Mm.
Correct? Now,
that's how deceleration happens.
That is how deceleration happens. Okay. Let's say, now in our this circle, okay, let's choose a different color, purple expression.
Why? If we did this with yellow, now we're doing purple.
If this is the delta V, that means at this time, if the acceleration will also be like this, at this time.
Only at this time.
Yeah, at this time the acceleration will be like this. Correct? Now this is obviously a rough picture. The more accurate we want to come closer to this yellow thing which we have drawn. Correct?
Mm.
That means the delta V becomes a point. Yeah? And what will be the direction of that delta V? The tangent of this circle. Not tangent of this circle, tangent of this circle. So this will be the direction. Correct? So that means that any given time the acceleration is a tangent to this velocity circle which you have drawn. Correct? Which means it is perpendicular to the velocity at that time.
Mm.
Have you found the acceleration direction? Direction of acceleration is at 90 degree of the velocity at that time.
It's the tangent of the tangent.
Tangent of the tangent.
Yay, I did something amazing. Very I said good. Tangent of the tangent.
Okay, now come to the actual thing. No, yes, very good. Now come to the actual thing.
Why?
Now come to the actual thing. Okay. Let's say this was the actual circle. Yes?
The tangent is just why? Why
not? Okay. At this point, let's say, forget this point now because you already know something there.
We haven't forgotten.
Okay. This is the velocity.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Hmm.
And the acceleration is perpendicular to this in this direction. This is the acceleration.
Okay, makes sense.
Yes?
So basically the radius is the acceleration is there.
No, direction of radius is the direction of acceleration. Acceleration will not be equal to radius, but it will have same direction towards the center of the circle. Yeah?
Radius. Makes a lot more sense than what I said.
Correct. But you also realize that this is also makes sense intuitively. Why? Because
Papa, I want to say one thing. The tangent, the acceleration ka direction is the tangent of the tangent, which is also equal to the direction of of the thing, like the tangent, like the thing that the, like the tangent that like the tangent like the thing that
radius like towards the direction towards the radius.
No, I'm saying like the tangent, what the tangent is, it's the tangent of that thing.
Yeah, tangent is perpendicular to the radius, no?
Huh.
So this is a tangent.
What
you're saying is this, that the acceleration is tangent to this circle.
No, I'm saying, listen.
We have drawn velocity circle here, no? Yeah. To that tangent would have come this side.
makes a lot more sense because I did not say anything,
we
right?
We have drawn this velocity circle here, no?
Yes. Wait, listen. What I was saying. Let me say it correctly at least. Acceleration ka direction is the tangent of the tangent, but the and also equal to the direction of what the tangent is the tangent of.
Okay.
Okay. Oh shit.
Okay.
Enough.
What I was saying is that this makes sense. Why? Acceleration is changing the direction of velocity.
Hmm.
How is the velocity changing? It is trying to pull itself towards the center all the time. The velocity would have made the thing run away, but the next instant it gets pulled towards the center. That's why it remains in the center.
Yeah, correct.
So acceleration is basically acting towards the center of the circle.
Makes more sense.
Also, what it means is that the force which will be causing this acceleration, acceleration has to be caused by a force, no?
Mm.
The force which will be causing this acceleration will also be directed towards the center of the circle.
Mm.
It's a pulling force.
And a pushing force.
Whether it is a pulling or pushing force, but In this case, if it is tied with a string, it looks like it's a pulling force. The string is pulling this object towards the center all the time.
Hmm.
Correct? Okay.
Wait, just give me a pen once. Just once. Mm. Look at this. You have been forgotten.
Okay. Okay. Now, what he says is that try to twirl a stone on a string. You will clearly feel the need for muscular exertion or need to pull in order to do this, in order to twirl the
force. So that the rope doesn't fly out of hand.
But why is this force required? Why do you need to pull the force? Why do you need feel that pull in your hand? After all, isn't the body moving uniformly? It is moving uniformly at the same speed. Why do you feel that pull? The whole point here is that it isn't. It is not moving uniformly. The body is moving at a constant speed, but the continuous change in direction of the velocity makes the motion accelerated, or it is an acceleration. Acceleration will be caused by a force that we know, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Newton said that. The force is necessary in order to deflect the body from its straight path or inertial motion. Remember inertial motion? Correct. There is a requirement of a force to...
What is inertial motion?
Inertial motion was uniform rectilinear motion.
Okay.
Hmm?
Anything can be inertial frame of reference, that is, if it's uniform and...
If it is uniform and
rectilinear.
Correct. The force is needed in order to create this acceleration, which we calculated as V square upon R, okay, which we have just computed. Now, according to Newton's law, force is always pointed in the direction of the acceleration, correct? And this is what I just told you, okay? That means the force will continuously be body revolving around a circle with a constant speed would be subjected to action of a force which is directed along a radius towards the center of the circle. Okay? And the radius is the direction and it is moved, the arrow will point towards the center. Yeah? It's a pulling force towards the center. Correct? So the direction of force is going to be same as direction of acceleration. Okay? This particular force acting on the stone which is exerted by this string is called centripetal force.
I've heard of it before.
Centripetal force. This is not same as centrifugal force. It's centripetal force.
What is centripetal?
We will learn about that also. It is just this force that supplies the acceleration of this V square upon R.
Okay. supplies the acceleration of
V. Okay, it causes that acceleration.
This acceleration
ka value is V square upon R. We have calculated that value, no? Using this substitution here.
Papa, even though the acceleration is like this, okay, understood. I thought even the acceleration is like this, why is the body pushing like this? Then I understood that one, it's moving like this. Two, the tension of the string is this.
Correct.
Right. That's why your body feels this pull, and that's why your body feels this pull. Like your body feels that the string is trying to run away.
The body feels trying to run away.
Is that centripetal force or that centrifugal?
No, that would be okay. Let's see. The string pulls the stone. The stone pulls the string. You remember, forces will always be appearing in
equal and opposite
pairs. Correct. An action,
equal is a action and reaction. Correct.
Okay.
So every force has equal. Every force has a
equal and opposite reaction.
Yeah. Okay. I remember that.
So, if the centripetal force is acting on the stone towards the center, the stone will also be exerting a force which will be exactly opposite on the string, which will be directed exactly outwards. Correct?
Which will be equal
away
and opposite,
from the center,
yeah.
Which will be equal and opposite. This force which is acting opposite outwards away from center and is equal to the centripetal force, this one is called the centripetal center, centripetal and centrifugal.
I call it centipede force. So the centipede force is this acceleration, and the centrifugal force, which is easier to say, is the force which, the pull which you feel.
Exactly. You are moving that stone in a circle. That means you are exerting a force to keep it towards the center, which is a centripetal force.
Wow.
The stone, on the other hand, is exerting a different force upon you as a reaction force, which is trying to pull away. That is the force.
It's trying to be like, let me free, I want to stay alive.
Correct. So
I'm getting dizzy.
So that force is what you feel on your hand, and that is called the centrifugal force. Okay, so tension in the string which is acting outwards is actually centrifugal force. Okay. So centrifugal force acts on a body, counteracting the tendency of the revolving body to move rectilinearly. Okay. What we have said applies also to the case when the role of the string is played by gravity. Like when the moon revolves around the earth, what is it that retains our satellites? Why don't it go off following the law of inertia into a straight line into somewhere else? In an interplanetary trip,
isn't that because of the gravitational orbit of the earth?
Why is it called gravitational orbit? Because gravity is a centrifugal force which is keeping that a satellite at that distance.
It's not a it's a centripetal force.
No.
Yes.
Centripetal force is keeping it in the center. Oh. Yeah, correct.
It is a centripetal, Papa. It's like that.
It is, you have to remember this. Centripetal and centrifugal forces cannot appear independently. Whether you call it centrifugal force or centripetal force, it is the same thing. Only the direction is going to be different. They have to appear in a pair. They are action and reaction to each other.
Papa, forces cannot act individually.
No, forces cannot appear individually.
Okay. Papa, so the pull of the gravity is a centripetal force and the satellite is trying to go away, right? Because of the gravity it's staying there. So that going away force is the centrifugal force.
Okay.
No.
Okay.
Makes more sense.
Okay, agreed. So what is it that retains our satellite? Why don't they go off? Following the inertia law of inertia, the earthing holding on to moon with an invisible string, the gravitational force.
This force is equal to
mass into acceleration. Remember, we had found out that if you put the units correctly, the constant can be removed and force can be equal to mass into acceleration, like that what Newton said. Correct.
Ab I also remembered that hum log cosmos mein padha tha that the gravitational motion, the gravitational pull is dependent upon the mass of the object.
Correct, but that is completely different thing.
No, I'm saying like that.
Yeah, it is dependent upon the mass of the object and the difference between the distance between them.
Because you're talking about gravity, I just put it up.
Yeah. Okay. So this force is equal to mass into acceleration. What is acceleration? V square upon R. That means the force of gravity is going to be mv square by R. Remember universal law of gravity I told you? It is mv square minus mv square upon r square or something.
What is mv square?
Okay, wait, forget it. Leave it.
What does mv square?
Mass into velocity.
Achha, right.
Mass into velocity square. So the mass into mass into velocity square upon r is going to be the force of gravity between earth and moon. Correct?
Makes sense.
Okay. Where v is the speed of motion of the lunar orbit, what is the speed of moon in its orbit, okay, and r is the radius, basically it is the distance from earth to moon. Correct.
It is about 3 million something.
Yeah, something. Okay.
I don't remember, it is some 3 lakh or something.
Okay, we'll see. And centrifugal force in this case acts on earth, but because the earth has great mass, it is only slightly influences the character of our own planet's motion. Because there is so much difference between earth and moon ka mass, so even though moon applies a centrifugal force on earth, remember the moon is the rotating object.
Yeah.
Moon applies a centrifugal force on earth, it's not really able to pull earth with that centrifugal force. It doesn't change Earth's motion in many ways.
Because Earth is also being pulled by a string of the sun.
That is one part. Second part is, yes, correct. Second part is that the mass of Earth is too much when compared to Moon.
Yeah, correct. Okay. That is also...
Remember, acceleration, the amount of acceleration a force can cause depends upon mass. That's why you can kick a football with greater acceleration.
Yeah, correct.
And you can't kick a truck with zero acceleration because the mass of truck is too much. Correct? Exactly same thing happens here.
Yeah, it will actually not move the truck, it will break your leg.
Precisely. So, exactly similar manner, Moon is not able to move Earth at all by centrifugal force, but Earth is able to hold Moon in an orbit with the centripetal force, which is equal to mass of Moon into V square upon R. Okay?
Mass of Moon into V square upon
R is the distance from Earth to Moon, V is the velocity, speed of Moon.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, let's say suppose it is required to send an artificial Earth satellite into a circular orbit at a distance of around 300 kilometers from Earth's surface. Okay.
Is that even how far Earth's atmosphere goes?
That is roughly where a satellite may be positioned.
Earth's atmosphere goes up to what height?
I don't know, sir, around 100 kilometers or something.
Okay.
Earth's atmosphere does not just finish off, no, it changes according to
homosphere, then
the stratosphere.
It
becomes thinner and thinner.
Yeah.
And that is how it goes.
Then you go out at the planet.
Okay. So let's say we have Earth here. Keep Earth green.
Please. Makes more sense.
Okay.
I want more green.
Now we want to put a satellite in space.
Which is blue.
Which is blue. Okay.
It looks like a mosquito. And that looks like a ball which will kill the mosquito.
Okay, wait now.
Okay.
Now we have got.
Delete the yellow.
This distance.
Okay.
Which is. How far are we going to put the satellite? At a distance of, let's say.
Day.
300 kilometers.
Isn't distance S?
Oh, that is only in that one equation.
What equation? Is that
acceleration wala equation. S is equal to, remember, S is equal to half AT into V0.
Yeah, correct. Yeah, that is some other
only equation. In that. Which is now 300,000 meters. Okay?
Okay.
This is the distance. Okay. What should be the speed of this satellite so that it remains at this radius, so that we can create a centripetal force and a centrifugal force which will balance the satellite in this particular radius?
2000 meters per second.
How do we calculate this? We know the acceleration which is going to come because of this. Acceleration is going to be, remember the acceleration?
Distance, something.
Acceleration on centripetal acceleration or centripetal
Thank
force
you for
causes.
Remembering that acceleration was purple.
Yeah, the centripetal force causes an acceleration in this direction. What is this acceleration in our case?
Gravity.
Acceleration due to gravity. So, our acceleration is
9.81 meters per second square.
Now we know the acceleration. Okay.
We need to know that is the complete.
Now what we have to find out? We know speed. The r. This is equal to r.
Speed.
Correct.
I want speed. Yes.
Yeah.
Give the values in yellow.
No, now we'll do that as per their color.
Okay.
R,
like we did this.
Okay, now we come to calculation which we will do in yellow.
Yay.
Okay, so what is our formula which we have? Acceleration is equal to?
Go yellow.
V square upon R. Okay. Now we have, what all values we have? We have 9.81, which is acceleration, is equal to? V square we don't have, correct? That is what we
have. Is V? V is speed, right?
V is speed, correct. We don't have the speed.
Yeah.
Okay. But we have the R distance, yeah. Which is 300,000.
R was radius, which is also distance, so continuation.
Okay, there is a mistake here that we have made. Okay. What we have done is mistake in our this thing.
Goodness.
In distance.
Why?
This part is wrong. Let's see, why is it wrong?
What?
Remember, you see this line which I have drawn?
Yes.
It is from the center of Earth.
Okay.
Correct? The distance
why?
Is not. Distance of 300 kilometers is from the surface of Earth.
Which is like a few hundred kilometers from.
300 kilometers. But
from the Earth's core.
What is the radius of Earth? That also has to be added, no? This
is
the radius
of Earth.
Radius of Earth is around 6,300 meters. 6,300 kilometers. Okay. So our total D is now going to be 6,300. Plus 300.
Which is equal to 6,600
kilometers. Which is going to be?
6,000 meters.
6,600,000 meters.
Why are there so many zeros?
Okay. Which means that.
Science is obsessed with zeros.
Science is obsessed with zeros and they deduce 10 to the power something something to do that, correct? Anyway, we will not use that to make it easy for you. Okay? Now let's...
It is not known 300 kilometers from the Earth's radius.
Earth's surface. If it is from 300 kilometers from Earth's radius, it will be inside Earth. Because Earth's radius itself is 6,000 kilometers. Correct? Yeah? Okay. So, now if we go ahead, so that means we can take the 6600 this end, which makes it 9.81 into 6600000.
Why?
V square. Correct?
I know why you put the zeros.
So then,
one, you want to irritate me. Two, it's the same unit.
Good. So what will be V now?
V will be
under root of this whole thing.
Okay, wow. I didn't remember that.
9.81 into square hai, to isko.
Oh, okay, makes more sense.
Okay?
Under root of this into itself.
Which is roughly equal to?
770.
Seriously. And what is the velocity curve?
Under root of this. Okay.
This whole thing is 7700.
Mm.
So what, and what is the unit? Velocity.
Mm.
Correct? Which means this satellite, if it has to hang on to its radius of 300 kilometers from Earth's surface, must move at a constant speed of 7.7 kilometers per second.
Mm.
And that also means that a satellite which has been launched into space and has been set to move at 7.7 kilometers per second will be rotating or will be revolving around Earth at 300 kilometers radius.
Mm.
These are called geosynchronous radiuses.
What?
No, they might not be geosynchronous.
What's a geosynchronous radius?
No, these are not geosynchronous radiuses, sorry. This velocity is called orbital velocity. My mistake.
What is a geosynchronous?
Geosynchronous radius is something wherein at that radius, that satellite, particular satellite, will move along with Earth continuously like this. That means it always remains on top of the same point on Earth. As the Earth
okay,
rotates,
makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, so that is geosynchronous. It synchronizes with the position on
Earth. Radius.
Hmm. Or geosynchronous, they're called geosynchronous satellites or geosynchronous radius. I'm not very sure. We'll have to check. Okay?
That doesn't matter.
That is not what we are studying here. What we are seeing is orbital velocity. So that means this is the orbital velocity. 7.7 kilometers per second is the orbital velocity at 300 kilometers orbit.
Wait. Halt.
So the minimum speed necessary for a body thrown horizontally to become an Earth satellite is called orbital velocity. And it is clear from this example that we have just given that this speed is close to 8 kilometers per second or 7.7 kilometers per second roughly. Okay? So that was the circular motion. And next topic appears to be quite interesting, which says life at G0, zero gravity. So we will do that next time.
Yeah.
Okay.
Can I just say stop?
Say it.
Stop recording.